Hi guys, my name is Vivek and in this video tutorial we are going to talk about hash partitioning in Oracle. Guys, if you have not seen my first few videos on partitioning, I will highly recommend that you pause this video and finish them first. They are actually the basic building blocks of partitioning and you will be able to appreciate this video in a better manner once you have completed them. Guys, I have another quick small request. If you have not subscribed to my channel already, please go ahead and do it now. And now let's discuss what we are going to learn in today's tutorial. So the first thing that we are going to learn, what is hash partitioning and what is its fundamental difference with list and range partitioning. Then we are going to talk about when and why we should use hash partitioning. And then we are going to learn it with a real practical example where I'm going to demonstrate hash partitioning on multiple tables implemented on multiple nodes in Oracle real application clustered environment. And guys, if you have not heard this term before, Oracle RAC, don't worry about it. We are going to discuss briefly what exactly it means. So let's go ahead and understand what is hash partitioning, how it's implemented, and what is its fundamental difference with range and list partitioning. So if you remember when I talked about list partitioning and range partitioning, predominantly our focus was on logically grouping the data based on our business needs. For example, in list partitioning, we used region as our partitioning key so that we can segregate the data of Asia Pacific, EMEA and North America in different segments. And when it came to range partitioning, we used date column so that we can separate historical data and maintain the latest data in a different partition. The focus of hash partitioning is actually different from these two. In hash partitioning, instead of focusing on data grouping, we actually focus on data distribution. So our main focus is dividing the data in equal sizes on all the partitions. And that is what I have mentioned here. How exactly Oracle implements it? So Oracle uses a hashing algorithm to equally distribute the data across partitions based on the partition key that we will specify. Now, as I've mentioned, this is not a great approach to manage historical data, which was the case with range partitioning. We had different partitions in different segments for different date range. So if I wanted to query data for a particular range, it would have been easier. And if I wanted to go ahead and drop a partition for a particular date range, that was easier as well. But here I have randomly distributed the data and we will see that how with our transaction demo table. So here I have my transaction demo fact table that has transaction ID as the surrogate key. And I'm going to use this particular key for my hash partitioning. The other columns are the employee that has performed the sale, the team to which that particular employee belongs. These are dimension columns, the customer, the product, the location where the sale happened. And then I have my measures as amount and profit. Now what I've done is I have partitioned this particular table transaction demo using partition by hash. That means I'm using hash partitioning. My partitioning key is transaction ID and I'm creating four partitions. Here if you see, I have not specified any values along with these partitions the way I did in list partitioning and range partitioning. In list partitioning, I had specified Asia Pacific, EMEA and North America. And in range partitioning, I had specified dates that, all right, if my value belongs between these two dates, insert that value in this particular partition. There is another syntax when it comes to hash partitioning. Instead of explicitly specifying the name of the partition, I can just specify the number of the partition that, all right, partition by hash on this particular key and create four partitions. That would do similar thing. If my transaction demo table has a billion row and if I go ahead and create four partitions, this is what's going to happen. On my storage disk, it's going to create four segments for four partitions and it's going to allocate almost equal amount of data on all the partitions. Now, what exactly should be the partitioning key if I want to opt for hash partitioning? I should opt for a key which is almost unique. So here I have opted for transaction ID as my partitioning key, which is my surrogate key. So it will be unique anyways for every record. Logically, think of this as using mod clause for partitioning. So what I'm doing here is I have my transaction ID column, which has unique values. I'm actually doing a mod by 4 on my transaction ID column. And if the result is 1, I will go ahead and insert that particular row in P1. If the result is 2 in P2, if the result is 3 in P3, and if the mod gives me 0, I'm going to insert that particular row in P4. Now, since my transaction ID is a surrogate key with incrementing values, it will always be distributed almost equally in all these 4 partitions. Let's go ahead and quickly recap when and why we should use hash partitioning. The first requirement always stays the same. When the data set is above 2 GB, it's a good contender for partitioning. So if your table is sufficiently large enough, then only you should partition it. The second thing I mentioned is when you want to distribute data equally among all the nodes on a massive parallelly processing platform that uses Oracle real application clusters, and we are going to understand this in detail in a moment. But if you see, the basic underlying concept remains the same. We are distributing our data equally among all the nodes. The third and the main usage of hash partitioning is we want to actually utilize full or partial partition wise joins with likely equal size partitions. And we will understand the last two statements in detail now with our transaction demo table. So here I have two tables, employee demo and summary, that are partitioned using the same strategy, hash partitioning. They have the same partitioning key, transaction ID, and the number of partitions involved are also the same, 4. Now let's go back and understand this with our mod example. When my customer makes my first sale and I create a record with transaction ID 1, which will be common both for employee demo and summary table, it will go ahead and get inserted in partition P1 for employee demo and P1S for summary table. When I get my second row, it will get inserted in P2 and P2S and so on. When I reach to transaction ID 5, it will be inserted in partition 1 in both employee demo and summary table. Now, what exactly is the advantage that I am gaining by partitioning two tables on the same key with the same number of partitions? Let's see that with a reporting scenario. So here I have a report where I have to access complete summary and transaction demo table, and I have to determine revenue based on certain columns. Now I know that these two tables are to be joined on transaction ID. Since I've used similar partitioning strategy, my partition P1 from summary table can join independently with the partition P1 from transaction demo table. Similarly, P2 from summary table can join independently with P2 from the transaction demo table. And these join can actually happen in parallel. So instead of doing table level joins, I'm doing partition joins, and that too in parallel. So I'm gaining massive performance as part of that. And guys, in a moment, I will explain a real scenario where we implemented hash partitioning, though not in Oracle, but in a different columnar database on a multiple node cluster. And I will show you how exactly it worked. But hopefully it is clear right now that P1 from summary table and P1 from transaction demo table are of the same size, and they can join independently in parallel with partition 2 from transaction demo and partition 2 from summary table, thus improving the performance considerably. Now, right now I'm running the Oracle server on my laptop, that is a single machine. But if you are running a large data warehouse with gigabytes and terabytes of data, instead of running that on a single machine, you would rather run it on multiple nodes using Oracle real application clusters. So you will have a cluster that will have a bunch of nodes where your data will reside. As of now, we were talking about different partitions being stored on different segments. When we talk about real application clusters of Oracle, these partitions are actually stored on different nodes. That means they are stored on different physical machines. So my first partition from transaction demo table is going to get stored on node 1. The second partition from transaction demo table is going to get stored on node 2. Then my first partition from the summary table is going to get stored on node 1. Similarly, my second partition from summary table is going to get stored on node 2. And let's understand what is the advantage that I'm going to gain from this. So when I run my report, that actually has to access the entire summary table and entire transaction demo table, and it has to aggregate that particular data and generate a report. When it will use full partition joins, it does not have to go ahead and do that join across different nodes. It can do that on the same node, thus reducing the network traffic significantly between nodes. So let's understand it this way. I have two laptops where I am storing data corresponding to my Oracle server. So let's understand it this way. I have two laptops that I have connected using LAN, and I am storing the data of my Oracle server on these two laptops. If my transaction demo P1 is stored in one laptop, while my summary table partition P1 is stored on a different laptop, it has to use that LAN connection in order to process that data, and which is usually slow. So since I've used the same partition key and I'm storing similar partition data on the same nodes, when it will go ahead and do full partition joins, it will considerably reduce my network traffic. After it has generated the aggregated value from all nodes, it's going to concatenate them and display them as a part of report. So in one of the project where I worked and I used hash partitioning extensively, though the database was not Oracle, but the concept remains similar. What we did is we divided our big fact tables using hash partitioning on transaction ID using this mod strategy that I just explained, and we stored chunks of data on different nodes. And then what we did is we replicated our small dimension tables on all the nodes. So when I had to perform joins between my dimension table and my huge fact tables, we reduced the network congestion significantly by replicating our small dimensions on all the nodes while creating partitions of data of bigger tables, so that when join is performed, node 1 doesn't have to go and get data from node 2 and vice versa. They do their computation on the same node, aggregate the data, gather the final output, and finally it is appended by the master node and displayed as a part of the report, thus significantly saving network bandwidth and CPU utilization. And guys, trust me on this, if you have hundreds of terabytes of data in your data warehouse, hash partitioning actually plays a very vital strategy to divide the data on your nodes in an equal fashion. On top of that, you can go ahead and further divide your data on the base of range or on the base of list partitioning. But when you have such huge data and multiple nodes, it's always advised to actually equally distribute the data of huge tables on all the nodes, and for that, hash partitioning is like a boon. So if we have to quickly recap what we discussed today, hash partitioning focuses on data distribution predominantly instead of data grouping. Oracle actually uses its internal hashing algorithm on the partition key that we specify. The sole aim of that is equal data distribution across partitions. When we have an environment where we have multiple nodes in Oracle Real Application Cluster, In that case, these particular partitions will be stored on different nodes. The two main advantages that we are gaining from hash partitioning are full or partial partition joins in parallel, thus improving the performance incredibly. And the second big advantage was reduction in network bandwidth. By distributing data in a way that we are joining two big tables, they don't have to communicate between two different nodes. We can aggregate the data on a single node, and then finally, once the data is being aggregated, we can assemble or concatenate that particular output and display as a part of the report. So guys, that was it for hash partitioning. If you have any question, you can drop in a comment and I will try to clarify it as soon as possible. There is still a lot more to come. We are going to discuss about composite partitioning. And guys, if you are clear on list partitioning, range partitioning, hash partitioning and their respective use cases, composite partitioning is going to be a cakewalk. Then we are going to talk about reference partitioning, where we actually partition child parent tables on the same key. Then we are going to talk about local and global. We have already talked about them a little bit, but we are going to discuss them in further detail. And then we are going to talk about some enhancements that Oracle has conducted in 12c when it comes to partitioning and local and global index. So thanks a lot guys for watching today's video. And once again, if you have not subscribed to my channel, please go ahead and do it now.